So let's a couple more topics I definitely want to get to. Let's talk about site monitoring. In my statement to get this one going, I'm going to say the shortage of CRAs can be blamed for most site monitoring issues. Agree or disagree?
The shortage. It's
the
kind
shortage
of
CRAs.
It's a both.
It sounds a little back and forth, and Chris agrees, and Rebecca is going to go back and forth as well. Okay, good. I think we're going to have a lot to discuss here. It seems like we do have a shortage of CRAs in the industry, and I don't know if that's what you guys were debating or not, but it seems like we do. It seems like that's the cause of a lot of the turnover that we have, and obviously when you have a turnover in that CRA position, I think it can ultimately cause problems for sites. Rebecca, what are your thoughts on that? Do you have any companies where you feel like you've been working with the CRA for an extended period of time, and others where it seems to change quite often, and what problems arise as a result of that?
Yeah, and it's funny because I saw Sam and he was kind of like shortage. So I don't really know if there's a shortage of CRAs, but I do agree that CRAs bounce back and forth between different companies. And I think it's either for growth opportunities or different reasons. But sorry, Sam, I also think that the CROs are the ones that are causing a lot of the bouncing back and forth between different sites because of, you know, reorganization or, I mean, they reorganize every month. And I get it, you're not going to send a CRA to another state when you have another CRA that has the ability to take on a site in their state. But then what that causes to the site is we can go through 8 different CRAs in the course of a 2-year study, and that causes a lot of disruption. So we, I guess to answer your question, Ed, is we do work with some sponsors that have in-house CRAs. And again, sorry, Sam and CROs, but that is really, it's really preferred to the site because it feels more of a partnership. And in those cases, there's been less bouncing back and forth. So really, I've worked with the same 3 CRAs from this one sponsor for 9 years now. So it's you're right. Able to learn each other and really feel like a partnership rather than a CRA just coming in to do their job and try to find on.
And Sam, regardless of whether or not there is a shortage, every CRO needs qualified CRAs to work on their studies. And if you're short somebody, it's easy to say, hey, we're going to give a, you know, $10,000 signing bonus for any, you know, new talent that we hire this month. And that does seem to keep a steady flow of CRAs going from one CRO to the next one. I obviously believe that if we had more qualified, educated CRAs working in this space, that it would alleviate that some, you know, to some extent. But what are your thoughts on that, and how can we, you know, get more stability, I guess, into those positions?
So a couple things. Let me break that into a couple pieces. First, let's talk a little bit about the shortage. I really do not believe that there is a shortage. I think that, as Rebecca alluded to, it is such a competitive field. I could go on LinkedIn on my phone right now and find other CROs that are paying $10,000, $15,000 signing bonuses for highly experienced CRAs. Now, when we talk about creating a new generation of CRAs, I have seen some very successful models. I'm based here in the Research Triangle Park. We're very fortunate to have a number of top-tier universities here. And I think hiring some of those top students into training programs, teaching them up, getting them to understand the industry has really helped create qualified classes of CRAs. At the end of the day, it's a very difficult job. I mean, you are living out of a suitcase many times, out of a hotel room, eating at restaurants constantly, which appeals to some groups of people and not to others. So I think it's a whole bunch of things happening at the same time, but training those younger groups right out of college, I think, is a great way to get good talent. If I can add one other thing, I think that is another reason, not the only reason, but one reason we are seeing consolidation amongst the CROs in the news lately. That way, when you see large CROs combining, they're no longer competing over pools of highly qualified CRAs. And I think that is driving some of the M&A activity we're seeing.
And Chris, it looked like you were jotting some things down. What would you like to add to that?
Yeah, I would respectfully disagree with Sam about the shortage. I truly believe there is a shortage in the industry. I think he's got some great solutions, and I'm aware of a couple of those universities. They're right, as Sam said, in our backyard for training up folks, and they really do a wonderful job. One of the things that I violently agree with Sam, I ran a regional program at Pfizer, and regional meant that they didn't have to travel too much, but nevertheless, we did have to make them travel. The first year it was glorious. Oh my gosh, we're on the road, we're independent, we get out to eat, I've got an expense account, we've got this, I'm earning bonus miles at the Marriott. You know, that's really pretty cool. That's the first year. The second year is, this is my job. And honest to goodness, by the third year, they're saying, is there something in data management for me? I mean, is there something else I might be able to do? So it is a tough road for a CRA, and a regional approach is a good way for them to try, for companies and CROs to try to manage it. And also therapeutic area. Don't make your CRAs, this is for CRAs, don't make your CRAs have to do a CNS trial, you know, in Washington, D.C., but then they've got to do a cardiovascular trial, and then they've got to do an asthma trial. That's a lot to handle. So we also tried to give them, you know, limit it to like two therapeutic areas so that they wouldn't have to stretch so far.
Those are great insights. And you know, you say it's a tough life, and I understand that. When I was younger, I traveled a lot more than I do now. And I realized always running through airports, eating in restaurants, you know, staying in hotel rooms. And that's not even your job. That's just required to do your job when you actually get there. It's not easy. And I know for me personally, when my desire to travel changed, it wasn't when I got married or bought a house or when I got old, it's when I adopted a puppy. Because as soon as that happened, you know, the puppy's importance started to rise. My desire to travel started to go down, and I never went back. We just got a great statement here from Camila. She says there are clinical research academies developing talents, and as that number grows, that should help the industry to get a more qualified workforce, which I agree. But at the same time, I feel like there were training programs that existed at one time that don't anymore. And I know over the years, I've had many people mention to me a wonderful training program that PPD used to have, where they brought in talent and trained them for that position. But it also seems like if you have a shortage and companies are often offering bonuses to get the right talent, you could end up spending a lot of money to get somebody trained and immediately lose them to another sponsor company or to a CRO, unless you put some kind of agreement in place saying, we'll train you to do this job, and then you're required to stay with us for 3 years or 5 years, whatever the case is. Chris, is that a solution? Does the industry itself need to start doing more training?
Yeah, it's a potential solution, and I was aware of the PPD. I called it the ROTC. So you're an ROTC, you're going to get your education, but then you have to do an equivalent amount of years of service kind of thing. So, and I believe there, I wasn't part of it, but I believe there was actually a contract that they signed with the CRAs to stay on for a period of time. And if they didn't, there was some funds that were withheld, certainly when they would leave. I would love to see more training. I would also love to see the sponsors come together. You're talking about Transcelerate. I know this isn't necessarily a focus of theirs, but it would be wonderful if they could create kind of this focus and create. I know there's an accreditation a group that actually accredits CRA training as well. So I think there are some things in the infrastructure, but it's not all boiled up successfully.
And Sam, you mentioned the CRO consolidation, and I understand when companies come together, they're no longer competing with each other for that talent. As that occurs, is there a possibility that CROs will take more of an active role in training the employees that they need?
I sure hope so, and I think that they will. And I'll give you an example of a CRO I worked at years ago. We brought in, I believe the class was 80 students at the end of every semester, again, from universities all over, but mainly here in the Research Triangle. At the end of that program, those students then chose the development course that they wanted to go into. Do they want to go into data management? Do they want to become a CRA? Do they want to go into, you know, whatever the department was, finance? And the vast majority of them became CRAs. I just think that it's so alluring, especially, you know, when you're young and fresh out of school, all that travel, the mileage, the eating out, the things like that. So I wonder if it's, Chris, going back to your point, when you were disagreeing with me, and I agree with you, that it's almost a burnout issue rather than, you know, it's like we have the people in the beginning and then it's just becomes a burnout issue as the job gets more demanding.
So one last question, Rebecca, I'll throw this one out to you. As decentralized trials become more of a thing, is that going to impact the CRA role? Can you see it getting to the point where maybe CRAs can sit in an office in North Carolina and somehow be reviewing documents and data at a site that they're not physically at? I heard somebody mention that to me last year. It was somebody who works for a very big company and is very knowledgeable about this, but he seems to feel that will be coming at some point.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much what's going on right now. So whether they're sitting at home or in a centralized office somewhere, that's definitely what is happening now. Again, that's more work on the site. But I want to chime in also regarding these training programs, because from the site level, it's actually it can be frustrating on the site level if someone just went through a 3-month training program and then they come on site, but they haven't been in the site's shoes, so they don't understand what it's like to be a coordinator, and they know by the book how everything's supposed to be, but they don't understand what it's like to go through the logistics of the day-to-day operations of a research site. So when some of my staff hear about a monitor that has no research experience, it's a little bit difficult to take advice from them.
So let me try the great topic you've picked here, Ed. So, and I'm not trying to give Rebecca any ideas that she doesn't already have, but one of the things that we're now seeing as a sponsor come through as a charge to us is if you give us a new CRA, you're going to pay us, the site, an additional $500 if you switch out CRAs. And it's like, are you kidding me? But then if I think about it, that site has got to train that CRA where the books are, where the bathroom is, where to find this document. And so the poor site does have to put in extra effort every time a new CRA walks through the door. So, yeah.
And Audrey, who's on the call, just mentioned there's an effort at Mass BioEd to train more graduates and others, and that Beth Harper and Lori Halloran, two of my favorite people in the industry, are both involved in that. So that I see as good news as well.